watching Talk of the Town. We're so glad that you have decided to be with us for the next few moments. We hope that you enjoy our program. It brings you some encouragement, and you have a good time. We were talking before the show started today. We were all talking about our kids and childhood and what's going on with our lives today. And we're laughing about a couple months ago. We were I was back home in West Virginia at my mom's house, and the phone rang. You know, they have a landline phone. It was on the wall. And my little boy, Micah, he's three. He was on the floor playing. He starts screaming. You know, he's like, "What's that noise? What's that noise? Mommy, mommy." And I was like, "It's a phone." And he looked up at, like, he was like, "What do you mean it's a phone?" He's never heard a landline before. He thought it was like a bomb or something. And so that started on our conversation of things are so different, you know, even from, and I mean, I just don't think that I'm that old, you know, yeah. But from when I was a kid until now, stuff is so different.
And it's changing. I mean, it's fast-paced.
Always.
Yeah, it's changing. And when you talk about phones, the landlines, it makes me think of party lines. Being the oldest one here, I can remember having a party line. Miss Sue across the street was on our party line, and I could pick up the phone and, you know, hear her talking. And I'd hang up. But my husband, he can remember what I call the Andy Griffin style, where he would pick up the phone, and I don't know what her name was, but so I'm just going to use this. "Sarah, get me George down the road." And she'd go, "Oh, George is not at home." She knew, he knew, you know. And
like
he,
on Green Acres.
Yeah. And he had an aunt that lived in another state, and she would call, and when they weren't at home, she would pick up the phone and say, "They're not at home, they'll be back about such and such." Well, it charged her, that long distance phone call.
How funny.
You know, but anyway.
Do you know what, did you have party lines?
Yes. Oh, yeah. In
did
Texas.
Did you ever listen to them?
Yes, I did.
I did, too.
I did.
We did, too.
You
had
I would
party
pick
lines
up the
too.
Phone.
See,
and I
kind of hate that I didn't have party lines.
Do you know what that
I would
is?
No, but, well, I'm getting it from, it's moved a lot of people.
I guess
but
people.
I would have been picking up the phone listening to what everybody was talking
about. Oh, everybody did.
Did you?
Everybody
yeah.
did.
They didn't have
yeah.
exciting
yeah.
lives, so it wasn't that interesting.
Do your homework on the phone together, old party line?
Oh, wow. Really?
What about burning your trash? Did you have trash pickup, or did you burn your trash? Do you know what I'm talking about
yes.
when I say burn your
yes.
trash?
Yes, in Texas, we burned our trash.
Tell me what that
yes.
meant.
Well, it just meant that you gathered everything up, and you once a week, you would burn your trash.
Okay, but did you keep your food scraps in a separate bowl or
bucket? Oh, yeah,
bucket?
The dogs got that.
Oh, yeah, the dogs got that. No, no,
no. Threw it under the hill, and that's where the animals
you
went
gave
to
the animals the, yeah. the scraps. That's right.
That yeah. was your scraps, and then you didn't burn that. It went over the hill
right.
to feed the animals.
Right.
And then your paper stuff or whatever went to get burned in the barrel. We had a big barrel.
So, but like, did you burn your plastic and your papers and all that?
Yeah,
well, there wasn't as much paper and plastic and all that as there is now. I mean, because everything was so commercial where, well, especially for me, where Mom made everything, it wasn't everything in a, it wasn't as much.
I don't think
you had more cans.
I don't think that's a good idea.
Anyway, because
it pops.
That was pretty cool, I thought it was.
Yeah. We did it anyway. You're right.
Well, we had a garbage man. We didn't remember. We had a garbage man. Sorry.
When I went to college, I can remember the first night I slept in my new college apartment. Big deal. And it's not like I was in New York or something. I was in Fairmont, West Virginia. But I can remember waking up to the sound of a garbage truck, and I didn't know what it was because it's loud, you know.
Yeah,
and I never.
Loud, yeah.
I used to just hear the crickets and, you know, the cows or whatever. And I remember going, "What's that noise? What's that noise?" But it just kept me up for a couple nights because the garbage truck and the siren, and I just wasn't used to it.
Yeah.
You said, though, when you were in college.
Well, when I was in college, I mean, it was a whole new world for me. I mean, I went to Nashville. You know,
from
Music
where,
City,
though? Where were you
from Texas, from San Antonio,
okay.
And I went to Nashville and went
to
Belmont,
okay.
Belmont University, and had never been away from home and had never had a shower, central heat and air.
Well,
I mean, I did have a shower growing up, but I meant never had an actual shower. Always took baths.
You had baths, right?
Yes,
but
always
so
took baths.
So there was just a big, like a big tub and
yeah,
but you had running
quite
water.
Large tub. Yeah. But yes, and I just when I went off to Nashville, I mean, it was great because I had just felt like I was a queen. I was.
But you knew what yeah. a shower was.
Yes, I knew what a shower was.
Your friends had them.
And my friends had them. And so when I went off to college, I was
uptown.
Uptown. That's right.
Uptown.
Yeah.
We never had showers either. We had the tub. And my grandparents even had the wash tub where they heated the water and put in it. Because I have a scar right here from it where I fell on.
Oh,
from the wash tub.
Wash tub?
Mm-hmm. She poured the hot water in there and it was hot.
It was hot.
We were talking too, you know, we're talking about the landline phones before the show started, and then about cell phones now. My kids are kind of younger, but your kids are older, and
yes.
we were talking about the mm-hmm. difference of opinions people have. When can your kid get a phone? You know, what's the right age? What are the rules when it's time to, you know, pass it on? Okay, it's your time to get a phone. I mean, what did you all do?
Yeah, I mean, I think every family's got to decide for themselves. Yeah. I mean, for us, it was, our son was 13. We waited kind of late, but we decided to let him have a phone.
I don't think that was.
I mean, he's 14.
Grade, but is that 13 to 6?
About,
seventh grade. Yeah.
And so we decided, and you know, he was starting to go, you know, get out of the house more, and he needed to, we needed to get in touch with him. Well, not drive quite yet, but.
So was he, did he want it though? Was he mad that he didn't have one before?
Well, everyone else had one at that time. So it was, you know, a little rough on him, but he adapted. He did really well, and he's done really well, you know, with technology. We just have to balance it. I think you do. Yes. I think you have to balance.
Well, your son Hunter's younger though.
He's younger, yes.
But he got his.
Well, 13, I think, was a good age. That's kind of what I was looking at. But his Nana, of course. Gotta love them grandparents.
And this is his Nana.
Nana. Solid fit for him to get it at 9. But it's, I know you probably run into this too. It's really hard to balance what the kids get because, like you said, everybody else already has it.
And our schedules are different. I mean, when you were 9, you weren't at ball, then after school practice, then you went to dance class, and then you had drum lessons. And
well, she did. I was just a teacher, so I was there with her.
Yeah. Well,
it's easier to
schedules.
Say no for the kids. It's not as easy to say no for the grandkids.
I do think that we are busier now. Our schedules
are, at least.
Yeah. And like my mom didn't work. You know, she stayed home and was a mom, and she ran, you know, us to do what we ever did, you know.
Yeah.
But now most homes, you know, both parents work and kids are in 1,000 different things, and a cell phone's almost become a necessity.
Yeah, it has.
Yeah, even for us. I mean, it is, you know.
Yeah, because, I mean, Hunter's staying after school for all kinds of stuff, so I like the fact that he has that phone now, which I'm pretty sure you do, too.
Oh, I do, too. It makes me feel like he's safe, and
better.
I can get in touch with him when I need to.
Right.
You can, I think, though. I think it's important that we put a limit or like the internet, you know what I mean, and that kind of stuff. If there's a password involved or getting into Facebook and all that stuff is a whole nother ball game, because that can be dangerous, you know, and it can be leading into stuff that we don't want them to be led into yet.
Right.
So I think that you can get a phone without the internet, right?
You can.
Oh, yeah.
And that's actually what Hunter's first one was. Hunter's did not have, you could call and you could text on it, and that was about it.
Well, our son, doesn't have internet still. I mean, he's just got a phone.
Is he dying, though, for it?
Well, he would probably like that. But he has access to the internet at home.
Well, sure.
I mean, you know, so.
But you're sitting here talking about phones, and it's kind of interesting because we went from party line to cell phones, you know, where we don't have home lines as much anymore, even from the bag cell phone to the little bitty cell phone.
You know, that's what I was going
to
say. That's what I was going to say when y'all were talking about your party lines and all that, and I didn't have anything to say about that. But I can remember when cell phones were in the bag.
Did you have one?
Yeah, we had one.
But only her mom had it.
The parents. It wasn't like mine personally. I didn't carry it around.
It was
with
just
me.
In our card. I mean, it's just one for the family.
I had a flip phone that was like this.
You
know what I mean? And I thought it was the coolest thing. And I honestly pretended I was on it when I was driving because I had 30 minutes a month, you know?
Yeah.
So I'd just be like,
well, you can you can even date movies now by the phones. You know, if you're watching
a
movie and you can see the big phone.
Or Saved by the Bell, when you look at it and they're having this, you know, big old block thing that they're talking about, and Zach Morris, you know, has his phone in his locker and it's this big.
Yeah, they've changed a lot.
But when I was a kid, phone-wise, the highlight of my life was when I got a little princess phone. But then I got in trouble one time. My dad taped it up and put it under my bed.
Taped your phone?
Yeah, because I'd gotten in trouble and he wanted me off the phone, so he just taped it up.
Everything, obviously times are changing, you know, as they say, everything changes constantly. Our technology, what we do, how we dress, where we work, where we go, what we watch, the amount of channels, everything that we have changes. But in a Christian's life, we do have comfort in knowing that God never changes.
Exactly.
The Bible tells us that He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And that's, to me, there's such peace and there's such comfort in knowing that. And so today, take a moment out of your life, you know, carve a few minutes out of your life and reflect on that. I know you got a lot going on. We all do. But today, choose to take a couple minutes and know that God is with you. He provides peace in a storm and can be your constant source of comfort in this time, even though times are changing. Right?
Right.
Absolutely.
Exactly.
Yes.
He is the same yesterday, today, and always. Yes, He is. And we hope that you get that out of our show today as we bring on a special guest we've got coming up.
All right, guys, we're going to have to take a real quick break, and we'll be back. So y'all stay tuned for more Talk of the Town.
And welcome back to Talk of the Town. Thank you for being with us today. We're so excited to have you. We have a very special guest that has joined us on the set. She is a dear, dear friend of mine. I love her dearly. She's no stranger to TV or radio. She's at her very own show, Jesus Talk Live. And so we're excited to introduce and to let you hear her story today. Miss Charlotte Bice, how are you today, Charlotte?
I am so blessed to be here with all my friends.
Oh,
and I am so proud to have them as my friend, and thank you for inviting me.
Well, we're just glad to have you here. You have such a unique story mm-hmm. that we want to share with everyone today, and we just want you to kind of, I want to hear a little bit about your childhood, because you had a special childhood, too.
I really did, and you know, I've been sitting watching and listening to you guys talk about change, and in my life, it's had a lot of changes.
Change.
I really relate to the outdoor Johns. We had a toilet. And I always said, you know, we weren't rich because ours was a one-holer. But I grew up in the country till I was about 8 or 9. And my daddy was an old-fashioned country preacher. Yes. And we have anything, hand-me-down clothes. We didn't have phone. We have TV. But we had a lot of love. And we had the good old-fashioned revivals, and all the time people coming to the house, because that's how we entertained yep. then. We didn't have, you know, like I said, no phone, no TV.
You had a lot of front porch time.
Front porch time, exactly. You hit
people
the nail on the head.
People wouldn't know what to do now, doing that.
Yeah.
No TV, no phone. People wouldn't know how to handle that.
No, I wouldn't know how to handle it.
I would not be like, what do I do now?
But that's all I knew at the time. But we moved to the big city of Morristown when I was about 8. And things were really changing. All of a sudden, you're talking about your child. We had street lights, and mm-hmm. oh man, and I thought I was something. I just walk up and down the sidewalks. You know, I'm a big city girl, walking up down the sidewalks. We had an indoor toilet, yes. And but I had a great childhood. Like I said, my daddy was a preacher. I was saved when I was 10. Mm-hmm. And so that's about what I knew was revivals and preaching and church, you know, and that sort of thing.
So you learned about Jesus early in your life.
Very early. My daddy was the kind of man that he really lived what he preached. Mm-hmm. You know, when he talked about Jesus, he would pray all the time. He had us, in fact, that's how I was saved one night. He had gathered all of us around the couch, and back then we called it the Devonet.
The Devonet?
The Devonet. I know you guys, some of you guys know about the Devonet, but we were all gathered around there, and being a 10-year-old girl, I was being 10 years old, I wasn't even thinking about the Lord yeah. or didn't know, you know, that much about anything, how to be saved, or you don't pay a lot of attention when you're 10, but I'd been around the Holy Spirit working and Daddy preaching, and I remember we had an old coal stove. This really is change, sitting over in the corner, and we were baking potatoes in the bottom. I know that sounds really weird, doesn't it? But that night, you know, we all bowed around the couch, and Daddy would always pray. But that particular night, the Holy Spirit spoke to me mm-hmm. personally, still can't get over it to this day, and told me that I was lost, and that if I didn't ask Jesus into my heart, I'd have to die and go to hell. And I got saved that night and didn't realize it. I waited till church. Mm-hmm. on Sunday to actually go up. I had a really good childhood, although it was poor. As people would look upon us, they would think, well, they're just poor people. But I was really a very rich person,
sure.
and
mm-hmm.
you know,
mm-hmm.
and more things than just stuff.
Yeah.
You know, so it was different from what my children have had.
You know, we were talking too before the show started about how a lot of times people think that the people on TV, or like you hear the story, you had a good childhood or whatever, and you think, man, their life's perfect, you know,
right.
my life's not, they can't relate. You're continuing your story, Charlotte. You've had your share of problems, your share of trials, and things weren't always rosy.
Absolutely not. You know, growing up in a sheltered home like that with good parents, you know, never had alcohol, no problems like that. But then when I got married and we had three children, I thought things would be the same. Mm-hmm. And I tried to raise my children trusting them. That's when pot and all these drugs just started coming into play. That, you know, we didn't have that when I was in high school.
Right.
And but my, I have two sons. When we first got married, we had three children in 4 years, I should say. And two of my sons got into drugs and alcohol. Mm-hmm. Started with the pot, broke my heart and my husband's heart because we had raised them in church.
Right.
We thought that's where they were going to be. And back then, not many people would recognize or would let you know that their children were doing that. So we mm-hmm. thought ours were the only ones. Because we were kind of yes. shunned
right.
And,
right.
and looked
right.
down upon. You know, Definitely. Even a preacher got up in the pulpit once and said, I'll never forget this. He said, if you raise your children right, then they won't get on drugs and alcohol.
Right.
And we didn't need that. We needed comforting because we had raised our children right.
And that's
exactly.
a problem. And I think that the church still faces that some today, but I do,
I do
think
too.
It's gotten better
yeah.
that
yes.
we pretend like there's no problems.
Yes.
Well, the rain falls on the just. The rain falls on the unjust,
mm-hmm.
and
exactly.
that's the Christian and the non-Christian. So rain happens on everyone.
Well, it's just easier to sweep it up under the rug
sure.
and pretend like it never happened.
Right.
It is. It really is. And I guess I would have done that myself some, except mm-hmm. they were so open with everything. Everybody in town knew what they
sure.
were doing.
They didn't hide it for you, huh?
No, I remember going to tell you a funny story during a hard time. I went to the bank one day, and this person says, she knew my name. She said, are you Brian's... My son Brian, are you Brian's mother? And I said, yes. And she said, is he in jail? This was the teller at the bank. Well, I looked at my watch. I do a lot of things to humor. And I said, well, you know, he wasn't when I left, but it's been about an hour. He could be.
Well, that's great that you could keep your humor like that through something like that.
Well, I tell you, Jesus Christ, his grace is sufficient. Mm-hmm. For all things, and he gives. My daddy had the humor, and I have done a lot of things through humor. But the changes that were going in my family at the time, with my children, I didn't really know how to handle them, because I never did that. Didn't do
right.
drugs, alcohol.
Right.
Didn't know there were such things as drugs.
I was gonna say, hadn't been
you were talking about aspirin and you know antibiotics or something, mm-hmm. And I didn't know about pain pills and all the different drugs. So I didn't know how to handle it, but we did a lot of praying, a lot of crying, a lot of getting them out of jail, out of wrecks, divorces, the things that drugs cause.
Yeah, yeah.
And then they, you know, would be in and out of church, and a lot of things happened during my life. But I guess one of the best things is when my brother was killed in a car accident. That wasn't a good thing, but it started drawing me closer to the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
And then my mother had Alzheimer's, and then my father died, mother died. And the more that came, the hardships came and the storms came, the more I got to reading my Bible
right.
and praying.
Yep.
Yes. Yep. And
when all those
the Lord
bad
really
things
was.
Were happening to you, especially with your children, you not knowing how to handle it, had to make you doubt yourself. Even though you'd been brought mm-hmm. up in this good Christian home and you had raised your children
yes.
in there, you still had to look back.
Constantly. It was a constant thing. If I hadn't worked, if I hadn't let them go do this, if I
right.
had have been more careful with this.
And or did
blah,
I push
blah, blah.
Religion down them too hard?
Exactly. Are they rebellious?
Mm-hmm.
And the whole bit. Well, as my life went on and as I began to really know who Jesus was, this verse kept coming across, give your body as a living sacrifice, and I learned one day that he really meant that. And so I learned that Jesus loved me and that God loved me so much that he let his own son die for me, and I just started to trust Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
So one day I decided to give him my body, and I was afraid though. I was afraid to do that because it's through ignorance. I was afraid that if I did, that all kinds of things would start happening to me. Well, after I gave him my body, I did get throat cancer. Jesus was there. It's been 15 years ago, by the way. It was a journey that I went on. My son, 31, died. Jesus was there. His grace was sufficient. So you're talking about changes. My life was changing, mm-hmm. changing. Then 3 years ago, I lost my husband. Jesus was there. Mm-hmm. And I always cry when I talk about Jesus. But His grace is sufficient. And like you said, as you guys were on the set a while ago, Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And I am so thankful for that. My life has had its ups and its downs. I've gone from the outhouse to a millionaire on paper at one time, owning motels in Gatlinburg, mm-hmm. back, lost the motels, went back to a mobile home. And I've learned this, like Apostle Paul said, I have learned in whatever state that I'm in to be content because Jesus is the same.
How awesome.
I think it's interesting that you are so, you know, you talked a little bit earlier about how you were told to act like everything was okay.
Uh-huh.
Act yep. like things are mm-hmm. perfect, especially sometimes if you're in ministry and do things.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
But I think even we, the church, the world needs to know, the world needs to understand that your life's not going to be perfect.
No.
And it's okay to be like, hey, right. guess what? I'm broke.
Hey, yes,
guess what?
It is.
I'm hurting yeah. because my kid's on drugs right. or mm-hmm. whatever, you know, the case may be. Right. And I think we need to be real.
I agree because, you know, Jesus warned in the Bible about hypocrisy. Uh-huh. And what hypocrisy is a hypocrite. Uh-huh. And a hypocrite or deceit is something that you're trying to get somebody to believe yeah. that you are or that you're not.
Yeah.
And we're
right.
all made out of dirt.
Right. Right.
Exactly. And we got to really realize that whether we got stuff, we came into this world yeah. naked, we're going to leave out naked.
Yeah. Yeah.
And you know, the main thing that I would like to get across to the guys, you can do all things through Christ Jesus who strengthens you.
We talked a little earlier on the show about, you know, times are changing, God's the same yesterday, today, and forever. And, you know, Charlotte talked about she had a lot and she had a little, but God was still God.
Yes.
So if you have a lot today, you might have a little tomorrow.
Exactly.
You know, we
true.
Don't really know.
He does.
But there is.
Every day is a new day.
Yeah. There's comfort in knowing that
oh,
He's
yes.
in control. And if He's Lord of your life, there's comfort in knowing that.
Yes.
Charlotte also sings.
She does.
And I
and a wonderful singer.
Oh,
a wonderful
thank you.
Singer. We've enjoyed her music on cruises and different things she's done with Heart Connection. And a beautiful voice. So we'd like to play one of her songs.
Yeah.
And let everyone out there see what Miss Charlotte.
Well,
does
this is really just showing who Jesus is because
there
this is
go.
After throat cancer, 35 radiation treatments and 2 surgeries.
Which you were told you'd never sing again.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Miss Charlotte Weiss.
Empty and broken, I came back to Him. A vessel so unworthy, so scarred with sin. He did not despair, started over again. And I bless the day He didn't throw this clay away. Over and over He molds me and makes me into His likeness. He fashions this old clay, a vessel of honor, I am today. All because Jesus didn't throw the clay away. Now He is the potter, I'm just the clay, molded in His image. There He wants me to stay. But sometimes I falter, I fall, this vessel breaks. But Jesus picks up the pieces. He doesn't throw the clay away. Over and over, He molds me and makes me into His likeness. He fashions this old clay vessel of honor I am today. All because Jesus didn't throw the clay away. A vessel of honor I am today. All because Jesus didn't throw His clay away.
Welcome back to Talk of the Town. I hope you enjoyed that song by Charlotte Bai. She is such a dear friend of mine, and I'm so thankful that she came today to be on our show, that we got to share her with you. I love to hear her story. It's the reason I ask her about talking about her childhood. I love to see her face when she talks about her dad and their home life, because she's such a special woman in my life, and I'm glad we got to share her with you and her story. You know, we've been talking about the world changing today, all the things that's went on in our lives, of how it's changed from that, you know, and she shared so much of that with her, with us, of her life with us, because she has had so many ups and downs and been a super Christian woman, but the ups and downs still came about. Mm-hmm. I mean, it was still there, the good times and the bad times, as it is in all of our lives. You know, we try to do what we're supposed to do, to be a good person, but it happens. Life happens.
Life does happen. The rain falls on the just and the rain falls on the unjust, but you know, God is faithful. He is with you. It's your choice to reach out to Him today. Thank you for being with us on Talk of the Town.